the opportunity you've given me to feed the flock.
Thank you.
I pray in the name of Jesus that the Holy Spirit would be upon me.
Thank you, God.
So that with crystal clarity I can declare and articulate the word of God.
Thank you, God.
Allow me to reach the babe in Christ along with the most seasoned Christian.
Thank you, God.
That they both may be able to drink from your living water.
Thank you.
And I thank you for what you already done.
Thank you, God.
For what you're doing right now.
Thank you.
And for what you're about to do in this. In the name of Jesus, I pray. God's people said amen.
Amen.
Isn't it good to be here?
Amen.
Considering all that's going on in the world, it sure is good to be here.
Amen.
Considering all the places that you could have been, it's good to be here.
Yes.
Doesn't this beat being in the nursing home?
Yes.
Or the liquor house? Or the halfway house? Or the crack house? Doesn't this beat being in the halfway house or cell block B? Or the psych ward? I say, isn't it good to be here? People who went through what you went through and they lost their mind. I know you gotta act like you're supposed to be here, but you know and I know that you almost lost it. Passage of scripture from Hebrews the 13th chapter, verse number 7. Hebrews chapter 13, verse number 7. Remember them that have rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follows, considering the ends of their conversation. That's all I need. This has been an interesting 2 weeks. This general conference and all that's associated with it has been very enlightening and I hope will be impactful. Enlightening meaning eyes were open to things that were never seen before. Interesting in that it captured and maintained our attention. Impactful in that something came out of the experience that will bless the people of God. We elected 6 bishops, 6 chief pastors,
amen.
6 new persons to preside over 6 of the 20 Episcopal districts that make up the AME Church.
Amen.
We don't preach or teach about pastoring much for fear of looking self-serving. But in so doing, we deny the people of God a deeper understanding of the functionality of the church. Who is my pastor? And what is his or her role in my life? Now, in the absence of teaching, we have ascribed misplaced expectations on clergy persons. In the absence of this teaching, we expect them to become political. That they are supposed to be handshakers and baby kissers. You'd be surprised at the number of people who describe pastoral care as the shaking of hands and the kissing of babies. But that is really for people who are running for office. The real function of a pastor is to feed the sheep of God, of which the Holy Spirit has made them overseer. Unfortunately, many people have substituted fondling for feeding. And the result is a mutated church that suffers from malnutrition, but is stimulated by the fondlings of men. Oh, y'all don't like this kind of thing. So when we get in a fight, we don't have enough faith to get out of the fight. Because we've shaken the preacher's hand, but we haven't given our souls to the Lord Jesus.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's not my job to make you like me. I hope you like me, but it's not my job to make you like me because I'm not running or campaigning to be elected to any office. It's my job to usher in a move of God which takes you from one dimension to another. Verse 7 of Hebrews says, remember them who have ruled over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith followed, considering the ends of that conversation. Remember them who have ruled over you. Sounds like you're talking about a government official, or senator, or House of Representatives person, or a president. But it becomes crystal clear in the B part when it says, who have spoken unto you the word of God. Now, I know you're not going to like this, but there's a line of connection between who have spoken the word of God and who have authority or rule over you. Then it says, whose faith followed, considering the ends of their conversation. I want to talk for a few minutes about following the faith. Touch somebody and say, follow the faith.
Follow the faith.
It's not important that you follow me personally. It's too many of you for that. At my first church, I could have the entire church over to my house for dinner. They could get in a van and about 5 cars and line up like ducks, following behind the pastor. But now it's out of the question to try and shake 400 or 500 hands at one time or to have 125 cars following in a procession to somebody's house. My job is not to feed you physically. My job is to feed you the word of God. Now, you may not follow me because I'm human. And you don't need to follow me because I'm human just like you. But the faith that I have, the Bible says that's what you follow. Church, when everything is said and done, it is going to be faith that's going to make the difference in your life, in your family,
yes,
and in your church.
Yeah, yeah.
The mystery of ministry is in the faith that the person who leads the way has. It's not that his or her preaching, it's not in his or her preaching or their ability or to articulate the word of God, although that is helpful. It is not in the talent or the art of preaching that catapults a church to the next level, because I know people who can preach the horns off of Billy Goat. So that's not it. It's the persistent, relentless belief that God is able to do the supernatural and cause the church to become pregnant with the divine.
Yeah.
Remember them who have rule over you. Now, I don't know if any of you have noticed family structure, but family structure is very interesting to me. The mama's role and the father's role are very different within the family structure. Am I right about it?
Yes.
Everybody runs to mama with whatever they want because mama acts as a mediator. She is the one she's the go-between between them and to get to daddy. You see, they go to mama and mama prepares the way. Y'all ain't saying that, so let me see if I can make it live for you. This is what it sounds like. I said, honey, the children want to go to the car. Now they don't come to daddy, they go to mama. And it is not out of fear for daddy, but it is out of respect. When the Bible says, remember them in authority, it is not talking about the person, it is talking about the position. Because the person is a person just like you are. But the position is to be respected. Y'all ain't getting this. Even as angry as they get with Barack Obama, when they get ready to present him, a man will stand in the door and say, ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States, and even the people who hate him stand up. They stand up because it has nothing to do with the person, but everything to do with the position. You may not like him, you may not have voted for him, but he's the president, and when he comes in, you stand up out of respect for the position. There's a writer says, because they feed you the word of God. I don't know why you came to church this morning, but it ought to be to receive the word of God. Everything we do before the sermon, the prayers, the singing, the scripture, is us talking to God. But after that, it's God talking to us. It is the difference between a monologue and a dialogue. Without the word of God, we only have a monologue. It's not until the sermon that the worship celebration becomes a dialogue. And there should be nothing that distracts or prevents the preacher from telling us what thus says the Lord. I know amen goes right there. The Bible says, remember them who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow. What sets leaders apart is the measure of faith that they have. I'm gonna mess with somebody now. Somebody said mess with the preacher.
That's right.
Moses was anointed, but he had leadership problems. Moses was not a good leader because he had trouble getting people to where they needed to go. Moses got the children of Israel close to the promised land, but he did not get them into the promised land. Now the reason Moses struggled to get